Good morning and welcome to this worship service. My name is Carmen Little and I'm a lay leader with the Chetwynd Shared Ministry. It is my pleasure to be able to worship with you today. We begin with our call to worship. God knows each one of us personally and God loves each one of us. We thank God for such wondrous love. We come this day into the presence of God. We come with overflowing hearts. We celebrate God's mercy and compassion. Praise be to God who offers us hope. Amen. We begin with an opening prayer. Heavenly Father, you knew us before we were born. You love us into life. Open our hearts and our spirits today to hear your word for us. And upon hearing the word, may we be convinced of our call to ministry and mission through the church. Bless us with your presence and your powerful love, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. What can we do as we face an uncertain future? Surely we do face an uncertain future right now in our world. We're still dealing with COVID-19, and then there are the natural disasters like great earthquakes, floods, and hurricanes to think about. And in addition to natural disasters, we all face trials and problems on a personal level that can easily distract us from our faith, unless we guard against it. I want you to look with me at a man who faced crisis after crisis and yet found the inner strength and peace to rejoice in every situation. He was able to carry on this way because of his unique relationship with the Lord. So, let's get a grip on some truths today that can help us with our service for our Lord now and in the days to come. Note with me the text for today, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God which is at Corinth, with all the saints who are in all Asia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. Now if we are afflicted, it is for our consolation and salvation, which is effective for enduring the same sufferings which we also suffer. Or if we are comforted, it is for our consolation and salvation. And our hope for you is steadfast, because we know that as you are partakers of the sufferings, so also you will partake of the consolation. For we do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, of our trouble which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened beyond measure, above strength, so that we despaired even of life. Yes, we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead, who delivered us from so great a faith, pardon me, who delivered us from so great a death, and does deliver us, in whom we trust that he will still deliver us. You also helping together in prayer for us, that thanks may be given by many persons on our behalf for the gift granted to us through many. In this text, you will note that Paul deals with the subject of suffering, and certainly he knew about that subject personally and frequently. So exactly how did Paul continue victoriously through every hardship? In viewing this, we can learn how we too can face the future with assurance and peace. There are several things we need and can have in our lives to ensure a great present and future. We must have salvation. Paul relates how he has been going through a great deal of suffering, and it is apparent that the previous year had not been an easy one for him. But note that he has not lost any hope of salvation. Why? He is confident because our salvation is not dependent on the conditions under which we live. You see, Paul had something that the world could not take from him because the world had not given it to him. Do you have the assurance of salvation? You can, and certainly God wants you to be saved and to be assured that you are kept in his hand of security. Once we know that we have redemption in Christ, we can face anything with assurance because our salvation is anchored in Christ, who is at the right hand of God the Father. Note Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 39. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. With whom he justified, these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore, he is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Clearly, the Lord means for us to be assured of his presence, his power, his plan, and his permeance in our lives. Nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Philippians 4:4-13, we discover anew that the peace of God is ours, a peace which goes beyond understanding. And furthermore, the God of peace himself is with us. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do. And the God of peace will be with you. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at last your care for me has flourished again. Though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in regard of need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. We do not lose our salvation even when we are disobedient. We may not be where God wants us to be or even where we want to be in our walk with him. But we haven't really lost what he gave us. Our salvation is assured, sustained, and kept by the Lord. We must have determination. If we will keep our God-given responsibilities in the forefront of our minds and in the depths of our hearts, it will help keep us from concentrating on the negatives we face in life. You see, when we're walking with Jesus, doing his will and bringing him glory, a peace surrounds us that mankind, life itself, and no hardship can steal from us. Paul had faced a very difficult period in his life before writing the letter from which we're reading today. Yet, in the midst of all his troubles, he writes with confidence and determination. He does so because he has been walking with Jesus. Doing God's will can help us look at the needs of others even when we are facing trials. A man in New York committed suicide. His financial books were in good order, and so was the rest of his life. He left a note that read in part, "Not a word of encouragement in 30 years. I'm fed up." Somebody is waiting for you to share an encouraging word. In order to encourage others, as Paul is doing in 2 Corinthians, We must get our minds off ourselves and see our service to Christ and others as a sacred responsibility. Doing this will not only bring us joy and peace, it will also help someone else who is suffering. When we get our minds on our Lord, our family, and others, we can live with confidence in every situation. This is a commitment we must make if we expect to give our best and experience God's best. We must have appreciation. Paul speaks of the God of all comfort, the God who stands beside us. Paul rejoiced in every situation because he knew that God was with him. We must have an appreciation of all that God has done, is doing, and has promised to do if we expect to live in victory. With appreciation comes adoration, worship, and praise. And we lift up our hearts in gladness. We overcome the drag that can come about through hardships. We have the comfort of our Lord with us at all times. What a peace this brings to the heart of the child of God. No matter what the future holds, God will be with us. That gives us cause to rejoice. I can live without fear because I am blessed by the comforting presence of the Lord. As David penned, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." David goes even further when he writes of the valley of the shadow of death. No one desires to go through the valleys of life, but the truth is, you never know just how comforting God's presence is until you are in a deep valley, a place where the world cannot help you. It is in these valleys that we learn the meaning of David's words, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me." Yes, we have a friend closer than a brother. Our Lord is with us and is touched with the sorrows and hardships we face. And we must have dedication. Many people make resolutions, but they don't keep them. That diet you committed to, it only lasted a few weeks, maybe a few days, or perhaps only a few hours. It's strange, but resolutions can feel like a cement block tied around the neck. Most resolutions don't last more than 3 weeks. As Christians, we don't need to make a resolution, but rather we must have a new dedication to keep our commitments to God each day as believers. Make this commitment to live your life totally dependent on the Lord. Think carefully about what that means. It means that we place all that we are, all that we have, and all we hope to be at His feet. We cast our cares upon Him just as He told us to. This requires that we make up our minds to trust Him through all. We can do that because He has promised never to leave us nor forsake us. There is a poem. Life is a book in volumes 3, the past, the present, and the yet to be. The past is written and laid away. The present we are writing every day. The last and best of these volumes 3 is locked from sight. God holds the key. If we live, God is with us. If we die, we are with God. We were not born to lose. We are born again to win, and even in our daily life, we will win as we fully submit to the Spirit of God. We pray. Holy One, God of all creation, you call us to be your people, to carry your vision in this time and place, to go where you send us to help welcome your amazing good news. As we gather in the presence of the risen Christ to spread the news that your realm is near, fill us with your Holy Spirit, O God of all creation. Fill us with your glorious Spirit, that we may share your good news with the world in need. Amen. As we go out to meet a changing world, remember this. God alone is our rock and salvation. The risen Christ is calling each of us to share the good news of the realm of God. The realm of God is near, and we are on the way. Amen.